Thanks very much for the introduction and for the invitation for everybody coming here. And so we'd like to talk about homological mirror symmetry for punctured Riemann surfaces. And we'd like to approach the problem by decomposing a punctured Riemann surface into standard building blocks that are pairs of pens. Later on, we'll also talk about how some of the floor theoretic techniques can be applied to situations that are a little bit more general, just mentioning passing at the end. But for now, let's focus on just decomposing a punctured Riemann surface into a pair of pens. And it's very easy to see how you just, like, for example, this one has three pairs of pens. But for mirror symmetry reasons, let's follow the procedure by Minkowskis using tropical geometry. So, Minkowskis has a way of decomposing any hypersurface in projective toric variety into, like C star n into a pair of pens. But for Riemann surfaces, we consider it as a hypersurface in C star 2. So we consider Riemann surface near the tropical limit, meaning that it belongs to a degenerating family of hypersurfaces in C star 2 with the defining equation as Lorentz polynomials of this form. So here, d1, d2 are variables in C star 2, and then there's this t, and with this. There's this minus, and that's not visible, minus mu, and this mu is some convex piecewise linear function. So so if C belongs to this degenerating family of hypersurfaces, then it's near the tropical limit. And when we take the log of it, we get, and as T goes to infinity, we get a graph in R2. So this graph is the singular locus of this Legendre transform function, which is the singular locus of max of a bunch of linear functions. So just for example, what this is, ignore the top part for a second. So here is an example of a pair of pens, and with this as the defining Lorentz polynomial, it has three terms. And we can see that when we take the log of it, basically we replace z1 by, we replace the norm of z1 by t to a c1, and the norm of z2 by t to a c2, and then we take the log of it, then each of this function in here corresponds to basically an exponent for each of the monomials. So here there are three monomials, and then the exponent of 1 is 0, and then the exponent of x, it should be z, x1 is z1, and then x2 is z2. So we get three monomials, and then here, this line is where c1 is equal to c2, so, and then here is where c1 is equal to 0, so the singular locus is where, So this three lines is where, so this region is where C1 is the dominating one, and then this is where C2 is the biggest. That corresponds to this monomial being the dominating monomial, and then this is where they are tied. So so here, so the singular locus is where so the singular locus is this skeleton, and the complement. So the complement of this graph falls into several different components, and we can see from this procedure that each component corresponds to one of the monomial here, the monomial that that's dominating in this region. Okay, so if you haven't seen tropical geometry, there's a lot to digest, but the point here is that this Riemann surface will degenerate to this tropical graph or tropical hypersurface, and with several different components, and each component corresponds to one of the monomials here. Okay, so, and then once we get this graph, each vertex of the graph corresponds to a pair of pens. Any questions so far? For Fermilier symmetry, Abzed Arun-Kazakov studied the mirror symmetry from the SYZ perspective. Also, the mirror of this kind of objects are known in Horowitz or other works. But to study SYZ mirror symmetry, we need a torus vibration. And if you look at this pair of pens, and there is a S1 vibration on each of the legs, but in the middle, we don't get an S1 vibration for the whole thing. So what they did is to fatten up the middle, and then we end up getting a bigger space. That's a three-dimensional space, and then there is a T3 vibration. And so the mirror, the SYZ mirror in this work, is going to be a toric Landau-Ginzburg model with Y being the three-dimensional toric manifold. And what it is that we can have the moment, so the moment polytope for this three-dimensional toric manifold, we can get from this tropical picture. So here the tropical picture is two-dimensional. To get a three-dimensional picture, we consider having an actual coordinate that comes out of the board. And this actual coordinate eta is bigger than C1 here, and then bigger than C2 here, and then bigger than zero, bigger or equal to zero here. So this moment polytope is flat. It's flat here, and then it tilts up. So it looks like an octet. So for the pair of pens, this toric, the moment polytope, this is the octant is the moment polytope for C3. And the superpotential here is the toric monomial of weight 001. So it vanishes to order 1 on each of the three toric irreducible toric divisors. So it's as much as minus n. So, and then just for notation, the zero fiber of this holomorphic function, the superpotential, is the union of the irreducible toric divisors. And as we mentioned, because there isn't a S1 vibration for the whole thing, there's not a one-dimensional SYZ mirror. Instead, the mirror is a three-dimensional toric manifold. But if you look at the dimension of the critical locus of W, it's actually one-dimensional. So, and in fact, this has one-dimensional mirror, it's just a singular thing, but this is the stabilized mirror this, from the SYZ mirror symmetry perspective. Okay. And just to give another example, for example, for this one, is the example from the beginning, a torus with three punctures. Can you see the picture? Yes, no?
Can you remove the brightness?
Oh, yeah.
Can I draw it on the board?
Oh, yeah, okay. So this is just a picture from the beginning, like this torus with three punctures. And then that degenerates to this triangle with three legs. And I don't want to dwell on this example too much, just to show you that there is also the mirror is also this polytope where the here in the if we actually go through this the variables, you can see it's a polytope where it's flat on the triangles, and then on the for each phase, it falls up into a three-dimensional moment polytope. And so, well, for the mirror is actually, if you work out the detail, the mirror is O minus three bundle over P2. So, and the S is the fiber direction. So what I want to say is that, so this is the mirror, the B side of the mirror, that the structure that we hear on the B side, we'll talk in a second, is the matrix factorizations, which has a sheaf theoretic, which is sheaf theoretic by definition. It's some kind of a sheaf. So you can see that from this mirror, there is a cover of this moment polytope by each of the C3s. So each vertex corresponds to a C3, and there is a cover of it. So and then each C3 is a mirror to a pair of tens. So once we have this cover, we can compute the matrix factorization on this Landau-Ginzburg model by gluing together each of these toric pieces according to this tropical hypersurface. So from this tropical hypersurface, we can compute this the mirror in a sheaf theoretic way. There's a check model. It's a check model for the matrix factorization. And so the point of this project is to actually show that the A model can also be computed in a sheaf theoretic way that corresponds to how the check model computes the matrix factorizations. And the symplectic, the floor theory is not defined in a sheaf theoretic way, so it's more non-trivial compared to the matrix factorization set. So this is just a homological mirror symmetry statement that we want to prove. So we consider the C to be the punctured Riemann surface, and we consider the wrapped Foucault category for that is derived equivalent to the category of singularities, or equivalently matrix factorizations of the mirror. So this is one direction of mirror symmetry, and we use the Rapp Foucault category because the punctured Riemann surface is non-compact. And there's another direction of mirror symmetry that if you consider this as the B set, and then the Landau-Ginzburg model as the A set, then we need some like fiber west Rapp Foucault category for the Landau-Ginzburg model, but that's we won't talk about that direction. So for this direction, there are some other works. For example, there's this many author paper computing, proving this for punctured spheres and multiple covers of the spheres that covers a large amount of punctured Riemann surfaces. And there's this also work by Bachmann. And our work is different from those because we compute it by gluing together pair of tens. So just one slide for this this slide. It's a little bit abstract, but I think most people in the audience know matrix factorization very well. I just want to have one slide to explain what this slide means. So the mirror is supposed to be the category of singularities of the union of the toric divisors. And because this is a singular thing, the coherent sheaves, so normally we'll have the coherent sheaves, but because of this divisor is a singular thing, we actually consider this category of singularities. So, which is a category of coherent sheaves mod by, quotient by the perfect complexes. If this divisor is actually smooth, then every object has a resolution, finite resolution, but because it's not smooth, we can quotient out by the finite resolution to get this one. And another equivalent way of thinking about this is the matrix factorizations, where they're equivalent. We can think for matrix factorizations, there's this two periodic map. And the equivalence, you can see that by saying, so these two maps are supposed to multiply to equal to the superpotential. the equivalence is given by this O. So the I wrote an example of an object in the category of singularities to be the O D alpha K, where D alpha is one of the irreducible Turing divisors. So to get this, this is the co-kernel of if we set the so the equivalence is given by the co-kernel of this T1. And there is a theorem of Olov that says all of this will actually generate the category of singularities. So each of this D alpha is one of these irreducible Turing divisors. So just to give an example, for example, the mirror of Pierre Pan is C3 with superpotential SYZ, and we can either think of a object of the category of singularities as this R hat, with x equal to 0. X equal to 0 is a irreducible Turing divisor, and then this has a resolution by this periodic complex as exact. Or we can consider the matrix factorization set with this two periodic complex, and with x times yz equals to the superpotential. And then so this is the object of the matrix factorization, and to compute the morphisms, we just stack them. And it's all a bit algebraic, kind of hard with the geometric picture, but that's how we do the computations on the D side. Any questions? So let's move on to the raft of Foucaultian categories. So Hunter-Riemann surface is a can be thought of as a Liouville manifold if we just model each puncture, a neighborhood of each puncture by the cylindrical end. So this cylindrical end will be the positive synchronization of this the compact boundary circle. So there's a Liouville flow that just goes along the radial direction. And the object of the raft category, in addition to the compact objects that we normally see in the Foucaultian category, for the raft of Foucaultian category, we also need the non-compact objects. And the non-compact objects are required to be parallel to the Liouville flow in the cylindrical end. So all the objects in the raft Foucaultian category are embedded curves. For Riemann surface are just embedded curves, and then on each cylindrical end it goes parallel to the Liouville flow, just radially outward. And to compute the raft Foucaultian category, we want to consider a split generating set of Lagrangians. So the set of Lagrangians we want to consider are L alpha k's, where each L alpha, what are each alphas? For example, for this each component alpha, we'll have all the L alphas are Lagrangians that go along parallel to the Liouville flow along each of the cylinders, but along each bounded edge is going to just twist k times. So each L alpha contours the component. So L gamma will contour the red curve. L gamma will contour the C gamma component. And the L alpha is going to contour the alpha component. And then for each integer k, is going to twist along each bounded edge a multiple of k times. So this red curve is going to twist k times along each of the edge of this component. And then this n is just the, when we do tropical geometry, there's a length to this edge. N is the length of this edge. And then this k, so if this edge is 3, then it's going to twist 3 times. If k equals to 1. So, yeah. It's a multiple of k times. So it's going to twist n times k times. Yeah. so N is the length of the edge, and then yeah, so and then there is also this small adjustment. This delta depends on the degree of the normal bundle between this divisor and that divisor. So it's a small technical issue, and if you just care about the rough pi category of the surface, then we can just twist any number of times along each of the edge. But because we want to also think about the algebraic structures for mirror symmetry, we want to take L alpha k to end up being the corresponding object to O d alpha of k. So O d alpha of k has this Hilbert length, the size of the alpha. So if this length is 3, then L alpha 1 will twist 3 times on this edge in order to be a mirror object to O d alpha k. And then there's also this small adjustment that we don't need to pay attention to, let's not to pay too much attention to in this talk. So just for the split generating statement, we actually don't need all the k's. I didn't try to see what the minimal number of things there's a, you can, there, actually you only need very few, but for example, for each alpha, all we need is L alpha 0 and L alpha 1. Because if we think of having a circle here, then the downtwist of L alpha 0 along the circle gives L alpha 1. And then all the L alpha 0s along the circle cut the Riemann surface into pieces that are not homotopy. So we only need L alpha 0 and alpha 1 for the split generation statement, but we just include all L alpha k's to show the algebraic structure. So those are the objects that we want to consider. And just explain what the rough pi category is. So this so for the rough pi category, in an example, so for the rough pi category, we need to have a model. That means pick a Hamiltonian that defines the rough pi category. There are a couple of ways. One is the one defined in Apothea Seidel with this linear Hamiltonian at the infinity of the cylindrical ends, or the one in Apothea's paper with the quadratic Hamiltonian on the entire cylindrical ends. We just, for our purpose, we use this linear Hamiltonian at the end of the cylindrical ends. So with this Hamiltonian, and then we also have another a Hamiltonian Hn for each n, which is equal to just the n times h. So for each cylindrical n, we do this. And then the floor complex, then we can get the floor complex with this Hamiltonian perturbation. So the floor complex is generated by first perturb the first by L1 by Hn, and then intersect with L2. And then these are equivalent to considering the Hamiltonian trajectories that starts on L1 and ends on R2, which also corresponds to the rep orbits of the compact boundary. So for H2 in this picture, H2 has, so this this has two cylindrical ends, and this middle generator is the generator, the internal generator. So in this picture, we have L1 and L2 both equal to L. And L is a generator of the cylinder, the pi category of the cylinder. And first we have this intersection just to make L transverse to L. And then for each cylindrical n, this H2 gives two generators, X1 and X2. So far they are just random labels of the generators. And so with this Hamiltonian, we get this perturbed floor complex, and the wrapped floor complex, which are morphisms between L1 and L2, is given by the limit as n goes to infinity of this Hamiltonian perturbed vortexes. And in good cases, which is the case that we work with, that when all the higher order continuation maps are trivial, this is just a direct limit. You don't need the homotopy direct limit. Also in this case, all the continuation maps that we work with is just inclusion, because if we think of the four complex perturbed by H2, we'll have two generators on each end. It's going to be included in the four complex of H3 with three generators. So this initial two generators is mapped to the four complex perturbed by H3 just by inclusion. So as n goes to infinity, we have infinitely many generators indexed by z. So z worth of generators. So that's the four complex. So the generators in the RAF four complex is the limit as n goes to infinity. So each of this n you can think of as a representative of a generator in the RAF four complex. And then so far these generators are just labeled, they're labeled like monomials, but so far they're just random labels of generators, but then there is an algebraic structure on the four complexes given by counting holomorphic triangles. I'll just write down the boundaries since I'll talk about it later. So the boundaries are the boundary of the holomorphic triangles are time 2 perturbation by Hn of L0, and then time 1 perturbation by also Hn of L1, and then L2. So as n goes to infinity, so there are all this, so the continuation maps will induce a product on the RAF four complexes. So as n goes to infinity, so there are no higher order continuation maps, so it's just all linear order continuation maps that induce this structure on the four complex. And then the this triangle will say that 1 times x1 equals 2 x1. So we can see that the algebraic structure on the four complexes is just, So indeed, these generators are just like monomials multiplying together. So this green is just the Laurent polynomials. So in this example, the rough category of the cylinder is generated by L, and then the endomorphism of L is the Laurent polynomials. And then there are no higher order infinity structures in this case, but in general, we will have higher order polygons. And then on the other side, the mirror is C star generated by O, and then it's the same endomorphism algebra. And then for other objects, there's the unit embedding gives, we can represent other objects as module over this ring. So that gives the mirror symmetry for the cylinder. And just very briefly for the pair of hands, in the many other paper they did for all puncture spheres. So for the pair of pens, we no longer have x and x minus 1. But because we have a puncture here, then this is x and y. And then x multiply y no longer equals 1, because once we introduce this puncture, that kills this holomorphic disk. So we have x times y equals to 0. So for the pair of pens, the mirror is actually coherent sheaves for this singular thing x, x y equals to 0. And if you use Knorr periodicity, then this is equivalent to the three-dimensional mirror that I showed earlier. So we're just going to assume that we know what the mirror of the pair of pants is that we introduced earlier, and then it's just this mirror, and then we'll think about how to put all the pair of pants together. So how can we compute the rough chi category for the whole punctured Riemann surface from the rough chi category of each of the pair of pants? So there's this gluing procedure. First is generated by a split generated by all the Lagrangians that we saw earlier. And if we just work with those Lagrangians, we'll see that for a suitable model of the rough chi category, meaning that we can pick a Hamiltonian to define this rough chi category. Remember, the Hamiltonian we need to pick has this linear Hamiltonian along at the end of each cylindrical ends. But in the middle, the Hamiltonian doesn't have to do anything. So we can if we use that Hamiltonian, we can still just by brute force compute all the triangles. But then it's just become intractable if you also want to count all the holomorphic polygons, because the polygons can just go all over the Riemann surface. So by picking a suitable model, we can be creative in the middle by picking this Hamiltonian to do anything we want. In the middle, so that way we can localize all the holomorphic disks to each of the pair of pants. So we'll show you I'll show the Hamiltonian soon. So once we are in the suitable model of the rough chi category, then the morphism complexes are generated by, so the generator between two Lagrangians is given by the generator of all the generators in each pair of pants identified by some restriction maps. So take all the generators from each pair of pants and then identify them by some restriction maps, and that gives the generators for the whole thing. So, and then the A infinity products for the punctured Riemann surfaces are given by those in the pairs of pants. So just to say a bit more about what these maps are. So here we have a pair of pants, two pair of pants, and then another pair of pants. They intersect, they overlap in this middle cylinder. And then this is a bit like Wittenborn restriction. There is this restriction map from the floor complex of one pair of pants to the floor complex of the overlapping cylinder. And then there's another restriction map from this floor complex of this other pair of pants to the middle cylinder. And each of these restriction maps is a quotient map. So those restriction maps are here, and then the generators are identified by these quotient maps. And so this is the same spirit as Wittenborn restrictions, except that Wittenborn restriction, and also Apposite and Seto has a version of Wittenborn restriction for rough chi categories as A infinity functors. So this is very similar to those, except it doesn't apply directly in this case because it's hard to think of each pair of pants in this whole Riemann surface as a Liouville manifold by itself. Like altogether, simultaneously think of them as Liouville manifolds with compatible Liouville structure to the whole thing. And so, and to make the actions all compatible. So we have another way of doing the same kind of restriction that doesn't require to have an action. So it actually doesn't require much exactness. We don't need the action. So I'll explain that in a second. So and then we also show that this restriction map is just it only has this linear order. It doesn't have any higher order. It's a infinity functor that only has the first order. So this model of the Rapp-Kai category has this Hamiltonian that for each unbounded cylinders, it still does the linear Hamiltonian thing for each unbounded cylinders. But for on each bounded cylinder, instead of doing nothing, this Hamiltonian is going to be negative quadratic. So the yellow region is the overlapping cylinder. And then we'll make this Hamiltonian iteration to be negative quadratic for this part. And then when we enter this overlapping cylinder, we make it positive quadratic. And then when we exit this negative quadratic again, so overall, the Hamiltonian perturbation Hn will perturb this Lagrangian L alpha k by n times in the negative direction, and then 2n times in the positive direction, and then n times in the negative direction. And if this Lagrangian already started with k times, then in the middle it wraps 2n minus k times. But the Hamiltonian itself just turns this Lagrangian n times, and then 2n times in the positive direction, and n times in the negative direction. So overall, it actually did nothing if you add it all up, but it's going to localize the holomorphic disks. So we just do the Fourier theory, count holomorphic disks, all like before with this other Hn. So in the non-compact cylinders, it does the same thing as before, and then in the compact region, just compute holomorphic triangles and polygons just using this other agent instead. So what's going to happen when we use this Hamiltonian instead? There are two things that we need. First, we would like to have a restriction functor. So what is this restriction functor like? So once we have this Hamiltonian, we can show a statement that similar to the action filtration in the Viterbo restriction picture, that so the restriction is the restriction from the graph floor complex of one pair of pens. So if we just restrict our attention to one pair of pens for now, and then consider the Lagrangians in this pair of pens just as the restriction of the other Lagrangians. And then, we want to have a restriction functor from the Rapp complex of the pair of pens to the middle cylinder. Okay, we will have a statement that shows if any of the input of a holomorphic polygon in the pair of pens is contained outside this overlapping cylinder, then the output has to also outside the cylinder. So we have a pair of pens, and then we want to show that in the Rapp-Kai category, if we start counting any holomorphic polygons, if any input so there's a cylinder that we have a restriction from here to the cylinder. And if any of the input is outside the cylinder, then we want to show that the output is also outside the cylinder. Then this region here is going to be like ideal. So then we get wrapped category, the Fourier complex of the cylinder as a quotient complex of the Rapp floor complex of the pair of pens. And then this restriction map only has order one, so it's actually an infinity functor. So that's one piece, so that's the restriction.
Do you mean any disk in the whole thing?
No, any disk just in the pair of pens.
Okay.
Yeah, so now the second ingredient is about this in the whole thing. So if you have any this, so we want to show that once we use this Hamiltonian for n big enough, because the raft floor, to compute the raft algebraic structures in the raft category, we only care about the behavior as n large enough. So so as n large enough, we can show that if you know what the input and output are for a holomorphic disk, then for n large enough, then no holomorphic disk will actually travel through two different pair of kinds. So as n large enough, all the holomorphic polygons will all be contained in a single pair of kinds. So then to compute the A infinity structure is more clear. So what happens will be if you want to do computation of an A infinity structure, we'll know that either it's just going to be a holomorphic triangle in the overlapping cylinder, then it's just a computation in the cylinder. Or if we have a holomorphic polygon, then and one of the input is in one of the cylinders, in one of the pair of pens, and we know that it has to be a computation in this pair of pens. So the output, then it just becomes a computation in one of the pair of pens. Yeah, so there's no ambiguity about how to compute A infinity structures. So I just want to explain two things, like how to show two things, how these restriction functors work for two statements. One is how the statement that if any of the input is outside the cylinder, then the output is also outside the cylinder. That gives the restriction map. And another thing is that no holomorphic polygons will go through the cylinder into another pair of pens. So that's two statements we would like to show. Yeah, so I said this restriction map, actually the construction of this restriction map doesn't actually depend on action, so it's different from the Viterbo style restrictions. So if you just draw this part, consider a pair of pens, and if you just draw this if you draw it in the universal cover of the cylinder. So this is the universal cover of the cylinder, and then say this region is the overlapping region, the region with the overlapping cylinder. Then what can happen is that we can just have a, so suppose the output is actually in the cylinder. So suppose the output is actually somewhere in the cylinder. This output one. And there are two things that can happen. Either we just have a holomorphic triangle in the cylinder region, just completely inside the cylinder, or it's going to go into the pair of pens. So one feature of this Lagrangian that we notice is that it doesn't zigzag. It doesn't do this zigzagging. And also that once it goes out of the cylinder into the other region, it doesn't actually come back without having to go through another intersection point. So that's a two simple property of this Lagrangian that we use. And so what ends up is that all the configuration of the holomorphic disks are going to look like this. So if the output is in the cylinder, then we always end up with holomorphic polygons that look a bit like this. So from this output, there are two curves that comes out of this output. So in one direction, we have things that are like this. It's all twisted. So suppose we have a D gun, a D plus one gun. So we have VD of HN of L0. And then it keeps going like this would be b, b minus 1 of hn 1 and so on. Well, until it goes out of the cylinder into the other region, and then we just cut it off. So this curve starts from the output and it just goes somewhere here. And then in the other direction, from this output, we have LD, and then we can also have something like V1 of Hn LD minus 1. Okay, so there are these two curves that starts from this output. One is the one from this direction, the other from this direction. And we can observe that this direction always has a bigger slope compared to this direction, because this direction is twisted more. Because as n become large enough, so all the L0, L1s can have a slightly different slope, but they're kind of negligible compared to this big twisting by Hn. So because this in this direction is twisted more, because we have V twist and V minus 1 twist, and whereas this direction is always twisted less, with no twist and just one twist and so on. So this direction always has a bigger slope. So as n gets very big, the one with the bigger slope will start to cross and kill this holomorphic disk. So the result is that if the output is in the cylinder, there will not be any holomorphic disk that's in the pair of pans. So the only possible way, if the output is in the cylinder, then all the inputs are also in the cylinder. And so if any of the input is actually outside the cylinder, then the output is also outside the cylinder. So this region will form an ideal disk. And then this is a counting of all the A infinity structures. So we show that there's this A infinity functor that just quotient out this outside part, and that would be this restriction functor. Any questions about the restriction functor? And then to show that no holomorphic disk actually travels through the cylinder to another pair of pans, it's a bit of a similar argument. So if we have, again, if we draw the universal cover of the cylinder, and then we have some input here and here. First of all, there's one little observation that in order for any holomorphic disk to go through the cylinder, we cannot have any inputs in the middle cylindrical part, because in the cylindrical part, it always goes by some positive slope, and the orientation and the slope of this will say that any input in the middle cylinder, so in the middle cylinder, all the Lagrangians have positive slope, and outside they all have naked slope. And because of this slope, designated slopes, any inputs in the middle cylinder has like angle less than 90 degrees. So the maximum principle will say that this holomorphic disk wouldn't go to the other side. So any holomorphic disk that actually can possibly travel across to the other side doesn't have any input in the middle cylinder here. So at most you can have is the output here. So either it has nothing in the middle, no input or output in the middle, or it just have a output in the middle. So we also always end up with two curves of different slope. You can always pick two curves of different slope, and then as we twist, let n becomes large enough, they just start to cross and kills this holomorphic disk. So then there will, as n large enough, once we know what the input and output are in the wrapped category, then as n large enough, there will not be any holomorphic disk that travels through to the other pair of pans. Yeah, so that's the argument without having to mention action or, yeah, so. Yeah, so combine those, we get this term. Any questions about this? Yeah, so if you want to see how the generators are identified, so we have, it's a bit hard to see, so we can also label all the generators by monomials that are just like what we did before for the cylinder, except that because of all these twistings, the generators are labeled a bit differently. So here we have all the twistings in the negative direction, and then the twistings in the positive direction, and at some point it comes back to itself. So that's the minimum of the Hamiltonian. We label that as x0, and then x1, and then x-1, and so on. So once we do that label, and then we see, so this quotient map just lives. So you can see from this statement that we combine the generators from the pair of pens, but we live. So they only get identified if the generators are in the cylinder. So in the overlapping cylinder region, things get identified. And then not the generators that are not in the overlapping cylinder, we just leave them as they're just generators that we include. So the identification in the middle, so we have Xi, and then there will be another pair of pens coming from the other side that are labeled by X tilde of to some power, and the identification identifies Xi to X tilde of n times L minus K minus I from the other side. So here X and X tilde forms a homogeneous coordinates for a pair of homogeneous coordinates for the middle, which in the mirror set they look like homogeneous coordinate for the on the P1 for the mirror set. And then so that's how this X L alpha K corresponds to the Lamb bundle O, like the alpha K. So here, in the middle, D alpha is the middle triangle, but in this part is actually P1. So the X and X tilde acts like homogeneous coordinates for the middle P1. And then with the degrees difference, that's the difference between K and And similarly, we can consider the bimodule structure from that are generators between Lagrangians from two different components. They are also identified in the same way that corresponds to the computation of the matrix factorization in the other side. And so to complete the homological mirror symmetry picture, so we have this restriction from each pair of pens to the middle cylinder. And what we actually showed here is that the theorem that we have here says that actually the graph category for the whole puncture Riemann surface is a limit of this restriction map. And then similarly for the matrix factorization set, we have, I just wrote in terms of the Riemann functions on C3. So if we have a C3 with X, SYZ, and if we let X not equal to zero, then we have a restriction to this matrix factorization, which by canonical periodicity is equivalent to the coherence shifts on C star, which is the mirror to the cylinder. And then this is, so then the check model computation gives the matrix factorization as a limit of this restriction maps. And then this diagram, which we can show that is commutes to order one. And then there are some A infinity functor classification that we can compute by computing H1. That shows that if this commutes to order one, then this two, that shows that actually these two functors are homotopic. And then we can also show that the limits of homotopic functors gives categories that are quasi-isomorphic. So then that's how we have a homological mirror symmetry statement for the Raffkai category of puncture surfaces is equivalent to matrix factorizations of the mirrors. And for the last few minutes, I'll just, any questions before? So just one slide to comment about the floor theoretic computation that we did for the Riemann surface. So here we have a decomposition of the Riemann surface into a pair of bands. And we can see that from these arguments of how to construct the restriction functors and how to localize the holomorphic disks, that we use the fact about the Lagrangians that it doesn't zigzag. We pick Lagrangians that doesn't zigzag in the cylinder. And also, it doesn't, once it goes out of the pair of pans, it doesn't come back in like a homotopically trivial way. It actually has to go through another input before it comes back. So this can be, so long as we have Lagrangians, generating Lagrangians that behaves in this way, we can think about how to maybe apply this to more general situations. So if we have a Riemann surface, and then suppose we have two parts of it that are connected by the cylinder, then we have Lagrangians. Suppose it doesn't zigzag in the middle, and also if we just cut off the cylinder, then we see that the curves goes in and then goes out and come in into different set of curves. And then if none of these arcs zigzag, that's the first criterion. And then, so outside this cylinder, if it doesn't come back in like a homotopically trivial way, so that's the second criterion, then we can think of applying this general procedure to decompose the surface, any computation of Foucault category in this way. So, I think Gini and Evan Smith are working on introducing Novikov variables to for in the compact case we can they can introduce Novikov variables and then to compute the category of some compact Riemann surface like genus 2 by decomposing into a pair of pens. I mean it's not fully worked out yet, but the Novikov, so we have all these Hamiltonian perturbations. Once we introduce Novikov variables, we have to keep track of how the size of the triangles change and so on. And then,